If you want to dominate basketball court, you might learn from Michael Jordan. If you want to innovate, you might investigate Elon Musk. You might study Michael Jackson to learn how to perform. And if you want to train your mind to find peace, calm and purpose, monks are the experts. They are the calmest, happiest and most purposeful people on the earth. Jay was 18 and in first year of his business school when he was forced by his friend to hear a monk give a talk. He resisted. He said, why would a young guy who idolized top CEOs and business personalities will attend a monk's seminar? He had 0% interest in it. But you know, friends are friends. After a lot of negotiation, his friend finally convinced him to attend the talk. And once he heard the talk, Jay fell in love with the monk and his teachings. So much so that he took the life-changing decision to become a monk himself. Many years later, after learning all the teachings and philosophies of becoming a monk, he came to a realization that you don't have to wear a robe, walk around barefoot, or go to a mountain top to be a monk. Becoming monk is a mindset which anyone can adapt, and in today's day and age, it is necessary. We need to find calm, stillness, and peace. And to achieve that, Jay Shetty, in his book Think Like a Monk, lists down 3 ways to immerse oneself in monk mindset. Number 1. Let go. Your identity, negativity, fear, intentions. Number 2. Grow. Finding your purpose, setting up a routine, training your mind and dealing with ego. Number 3. Give. First to self in the form of gratitude, then giving in relationships, and finally to the society. Lesson number 1. Let go your identity. The Bhagavad Gita says, it is better to live in your own destiny imperfectly than to live an imitation of somebody else's life with perfection. Famous American sociologist Charles Cooley said, I am not who you think I am. I am not who I think I am. I am who I think you think I am. Confused? Well, our identity is wrapped up what others think of us, or more accurately, what we think others think of us. Most our efforts in self-improvement are just to meet that imagined ideal. Imagine you standing in front of a mirror with a thick layer of dust. Will you be able to see yourself clearly? Of course not. Similarly, our identity is layered by the definitions of the society and the media. For example, the world and society thinks wealth is a measure of success and you try to chase wealth. A particular opinion is more accepted. You form that opinion, or say a particular body shape is more beautiful and you aim to achieve it. We all run behind the things we lack. That's how businesses are run. Why do we do it? Because the media has painted a perception that this type of job, money or looks is desirable. And who funds the media? Well, the same set of people who runs the business. The point here is to know your true self. And how we do it? Identify your values. Question your actions. Cancel the outside noise and hear your inner voice. Do you think the thing which you are doing right now reflects your values? But where do these values come from? Through experience. Sit down and self-reflect your values. Say your value is kindness, and source of origin of this particular value is your parents. Is it true to me? Yes. Then go to the next value. Say appearance. What is the origin? Maybe the media. Is it true to me? Nope. Similarly, say wealth. Origin? Parents. But do you value wealth same as your parents do? Nope. And that's how you identify your core values and let go of your false values. Let go negativity. Negativity is generated from within. We all have 3 emotional needs: peace, love, and understanding. Negativity, if you break it down, often arises whenever we see a threat to either of these 3 emotions, like fear that bad thing is going to happen, loss of peace. Fear of not being loved, loss of love. Fear of being disrespected, loss of understanding. From these fears stem all the possible negative emotions you can think of. For example, think of the trolls on every comment section or in Twitter dropping ill will. Perhaps they fear they aren't respected and they turn to full-time trolling to feel significant. Or say the call to a friend to vent out all your feelings. Because you fear that bad things gonna happen and it'll affect the peace in your life. Well, negativity is everywhere and it is a part of life. What matters is how we handle it. There are 2 sources of negativity: external and internal. External is simple. You are able to identify the source. Say someone is being negative, or more worse, they are hurting you. You have the freedom to move away. or if you think you care for them, then help them. The other type is internal negativity. And to tackle that, Jay mentions three steps. Spot, stop, and swap. Be an observer of your own feelings and learn to identify when your thoughts are taking the negative path. So that is spotting. Then stop the thinking and try and swap them by noting and breaking down your thoughts. Say, I spotted a thought saying my math teacher is bad. Stop the thought. Now either note or think why you thought so. You may find the whole reason behind that thought was that she scolded you. She scolded you because you didn't do your assignment. And she was at the end doing her job. Let go fear. Fear can be good and bad. For example, in the story of Mahabharata, when hero and the great warrior Arjun saw his friends and family on the other side of the battle and realized that most of them will lose their lives, drops his bow. Even though being strongest fighter on the land, fear had caused him to lose connection with his ability. Same thing happens with us. Most of the time, fear and anxiety disconnects us from our abilities. This is also because we were taught from childhood that fear is negative. But instead, fear has a flip side. Fear isn't bad, it is a warning sign. It's like our mind says, this doesn't look good. Example, fear of climate change makes you take care of environment. Fear of failing an exam wakes you up to finish the syllabus. So use fear as a tool to push yourself out of your comfort zone. Accept your fear and walk with it. Let go wrong intentions. We have at least once have had a thought whenever we see someone dance or sing beautifully, God, I wish I could dance or sing like that. Now, the question you need to ask self is, do you actually wanna learn it out of your self-desire? Or wanna get that skill just because it's an impressive achievement? Or say you join gym after breakup to make revenge body, to make your ex jealous. What if he or she doesn't notice? Or what if they get someone more fitter than you? But if your intention instead is to get mentally and physically fit to move on, then that is healthy. So ask yourself, what is the motivation behind the task I am doing? Is it fear, desire, duty, or love? Your motivation sets your intention. Identify it and let go of the wrong intentions. Lesson 2. Grow. Grow in purpose. Finding your purpose takes its own time. Thanks to young billionaires like FB or Snapchat founder, the world expects us to be successful or find our purpose as early as possible. But 24 is not the age for everyone to achieve everything. Everyone finds their ambition at the right age. GOT's Peter Dinklage left his data processing job at 29. Ray Kroc started McDonald's at 52. Well, the key here is to keep trying and not stopping. Jay categorizes the work we do in 4 quadrants. 1. Skill and no purpose. Skill and purpose. No skill, no purpose. No skill, but purpose. The quadrant 3 is bad. No one ideally wants to be there. Try to move out ASAP unless you don't have any other way out. Quadrant 1 is where most of us falls. But you can insert your purpose into it and make it look interesting. For example, I had a friend who loved teaching but was working as a software engineer in IT. He slowly started tutoring the new joinees and now is a full-time IT trainer. The fourth quadrant will need your time and work. And in the current times, there's no such skill which cannot be monetized if done in the right way. Grow in routine. Why do you need a routine? Because it eases the day. It helps you build habits and simplify your decision making. Why do you think most of the top CEOs in the world wear the same thing? Well, because as a human, you are limited by the number of right decisions you can make in a day. Wasting your brain power in deciding the daily mundane task not only wastes time, but affects your work-life balance. Make sure you design a routine where you can give enough time to self and family or friends. A routine need not be boring. Look for something new in your routine. Example, start a conversation with the people you meet when you travel to work. A routine brings in discipline in your life and every successful people in the eyes of the world like celebrities or outside world like monks follow a routine. It helps you to be present in the moment and engage deep in task without getting distracted. Grow in mind. True growth requires understanding the mind. It is your mind that helps you go from the smallest choices like getting up from the bed to choices like deciding your purpose in life. In the ancient philosophical texts, the Upanishads, the working of mind is described as a chariot driven by 5 horses. In this analogy, the chariot is the body, the five horses are the five senses, the reins are the mind, and the charioteer is the intellect. In the untrained state, the charioteer, the intellect, is in sleep state. So the horses, senses, have control of the reins and take body wherever they feel. They have no control over them. In similar way, if we don't train our mind, our senses are activated in the moment by food, money, power, etc. Whereas in the trained state, the charioteer does not let the horses take control of the reins and directs them to take long and correct route. Grow in handling ego. Bhagavad Gita draws distinction between real ego and false ego. Real ego is us, your true self. False ego is mass, which is nothing but dishonest version of yourself. The Veda says, pride of wealth destroys wealth. Pride of strength destroys strength. Pride of knowledge destroys knowledge. Ego is our inflated persona of what we present to the outside world in the way we want to be seen. When we dress up, we want to be comfortable in what we wear, plain and simple. But ego wants more. It wants the praises, the attention. There's an actual meme which shows Warren Buffett and Bill Gates standing side by side in simple plain clothes. If you are satisfied with who you are, then there is no need to prove your worth to anyone. Ego makes us liars. Ego hinders our growth because you don't want to empty your cup or accept that you don't know something. Hence, practice humility. Never get big-headed. Or in more simpler way, remember that you will die one day. Lesson 3. Give. Give oneself. Gratitude can be described as the most powerful drug. We always complain in case of a misfortune, saying, "Oh God, why me?" But we never put the same question in case of a fortune. Gratitude is a drug that terminates negativity. You can't be both negative and positive at the same time. If you are listening to this summary, then you should be grateful enough that you have a smartphone and internet service. 4 billion population in the world doesn't have either. 700 million people in the world is without food. Being grateful for what you have is always healthier and generate kindness. That doesn't mean you stop your growth. There's a difference between being grateful for what you have versus settling for something less than what you deserve. Give in relationships. We often become selfish in our relationships and set unrealistic expectations from each other, be it friends, life partner, or family. What we need to do is be clear in our communication of what is expected and what is not. Relationships are a two-way process, always. The more love you give, the more love you receive. Give to society. Jay's guru, whom he first heard in his college, had said, "Plant trees under whose shadow you do not plan to sit." And this line alone sums up the definition of selfless service. The highest purpose of life is to live in service. Even Bill Gates has realized that. The act of giving has been proven to make people happier than if they had decided to use the thing for their own personal gain. It amplifies gratitude, gives you meaning and purpose, and in the end, makes your life better. Well, this completes the summary of the book, Think Like a Monk. I have covered briefly all the points mentioned in the book. If you want to know more, link is in the description. And if you are not subscribed to the channel yet, please do subscribe, like and share it with your friends and family. Thanks a lot for listening.